Well, good morning, Fellowship. Good to be able to connect again. Great to have you listening along, watching on video today. And we're back to doing online. And nothing wrong with that. Some of you never left online, I guess. But for the next little while, this is going to be the mode we use to encourage you through the teaching of God's Word and through the worship and music and those sorts of things. Can I just encourage you in two ways? Number one, our Facebook page will be the spot to go, and the website would be our website would be the second place to go for any information, any changes that are happening within the context of the church. We're going to post everything as quick as we can onto Facebook. And so make sure you like the church's Facebook page, and that way you'll get notification of any posts that goes up. The other thing I would encourage you to do is, while we're in this time of not being able to gather together as a church, as things have opened up and opportunities arise, could I just encourage you that while we're not going to be able to gather inside in the church as a church family, there are opportunities that you could take advantage of. For instance, meeting outside, you could gather together your D group, your growth group, and watch the message as a group one week. Or you could collect your family and another family and go and sit on chairs in your backyard and watch it that way. So there's good opportunities for us to engage with each other in the context of doing church service that perhaps we could take advantage of. So can I just encourage you to do that? We don't have to just do this all in complete isolation. We do have opportunities to gather outside and do some things as a church family, and to encourage each other and to have discussions about what's going on in our messages. The topics that we talk about, I hope, are really informative, but I also hope they're also instructive. In other words, I want us to learn lots, but I want us to be motivated to do lots in light of what we learn. So good to have you along for church. We hope you enjoy our service today. Worship the Lord together with us. Welcome to Fellowship.
Great. So my name is Kim Harborn, for those of you who might not know who I am. I'm Paul's wife, pastor of Fellowship Baptist Church. I'm also a mom to Tyler, Lindsay, and Brendan. So I was brought up in a Christian home, and I'm very grateful for the heritage that I have. My parents had me at church when I was a newborn, and our church family was very important to our family. And at a young age, I accepted the Lord. I was probably about 7 years old. And it was probably when I was about 16 or 17 at a Word of Life youth rally at MBC that I recognized that I really needed to rededicate my life completely to the Lord. My Christian walk has been challenging and exciting. Paul and I grew up in the same church together. So we actually ran around Sunday school together as the little kids, and then dated when we were in our senior high club at our church. And so our journey of faith together goes back quite a way. We were married about 5 years. He then just told me that he was really feeling God calling him to go to Bible school. And we were settled in Pickering with two children. Tyler would have been about 3 and Lindsay was just a baby when God radically got a hold of our lives and said that this is what he wanted us to do. And I'm going to say it wasn't easy for me because it meant leaving home where I was comfortable, leaving the church family that I'd known all my life. And it was really, it was a difficult time in my life where I had to really let go and let God, so to speak. But it turned out to be the best year of our lives. We headed off to the Word of Life Bible Institute in Screen Lake, New York with the kids, and we were as poor as paupers, but it was awesome. We lived in a little tiny cabin, and Paul studied for an entire year from September to September, and then God called us into ministry, and that was not part of our plan when we went there. And from there, Paul was asked to then finish his degree and become the professor of Bible Survey at Word of Life Bible Institute. So we had many years with Word of Life, and it was wonderful ministry opportunities there with young people. And if you were to ask me if my faith journey was easy, I would tell you no, it hasn't been easy. But if you had told me 35 years ago that Paul and I would be here in Collingwood at Fellowship Baptist, I probably would have laughed and said, us? There's no way. And yet God has moved us in miraculous ways, and yet he has been so faithful. And without him, I don't think I could have made it. He's taught me that even though those times of silence, he's not absent. He's working. And as a mom, just watching him work in my kids' lives and their now spouses and future spouses has been wonderful to see him work. And so I'm reminded over and over again during the difficult times just to stay close to him. And it has just been so rewarding to see God work in their lives and other lives. And as a mom's heart, just remembering that I need to continually bring them before him who loves them more than even I do. That's been huge for me. As a pastor's wife, I have learned that I felt very ill-equipped 12 years ago, if I'm completely honest. It was part of my faith journey that was at times terrifying, not knowing if I could be a pastor's wife. But again, it's been part of our journey together, and it's at times been hard, just because I'm in the background supporting Paul, and I'm not sure that I ever understood the role of a pastor's wife. I didn't, actually, until I'm in it now. It's been a learning experience for me, but again, also it's pushed me to trust and rely on him for the times where I feel very inadequate.
Uh, About that time, Herod the king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with a sword, and when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the days of unleavened bread. And when he had seized him, he put him in prison, delivering him over the 4 squads of soldiers to guard him, intending after the Passover to bring him out to the people. So Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. Now when Herod was about to bring him out, on that very night, Peter was sleeping between 2 soldiers, bound with 2 chains, and sentries before the door were guarding the prison. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood next to him, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly." And the chains fell off his hands. And the angel said to him, "Dress yourself and put on your sandals." And he did so. And he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." And he went out and followed him. He did not know that what was being done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they had passed the first and the second guard, they came to the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for him of its own accord, and they went out and went along one street, and immediately the angel left him. When Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I'm sure that the Lord has sent this angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." When he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name was Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. And when he knocked at the door of the gateway, a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer. Recognizing Peter's voice, in her joy she did not open the gate and ran in and reported that Peter was standing at the gate. They said to her, "You are out of your mind." But she kept insisting that it was so, and they kept saying, "It is his angel." But Peter continued knocking, and when they opened, they saw him and were amazed. But motioning to him with his hand to be silent, he described to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Tell these things to James and to the brothers." Then he departed and went to another place. Now when day came, there was no little disturbance among the soldiers over what had become of Peter. And after Herod searched for him and did not find him, he examined the sentries and ordered that they should be put to death. Then he went down from Judea to Caesarea and spent time there. Now Herod was angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, and they came to him with one accord. And having persuaded Blastus, the king's chamberlain, they asked for peace, because their country depended on the king's country for food. On an appointed day, Herod put on his royal robes, took his seat upon the throne, and delivered an oration to them, and the people were shouting, "The voice of a god and not of a man." Immediately an angel of the Lord struck him down, because he did not give God the glory, and he was eaten by worms and breathed his last. But the word of God increased and multiplied. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had completed their service, bringing with them John, whose other name was Mark.
Okay, so as we look at the book of Acts today, we're going to get back into our study. So turn to Acts chapter 12 right now. We heard it read for us and saw it read for us just a little bit ago. And so we want to dig into that and see what it is that God is going to now do in moving the story along in the spreading of the gospel from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and now to the uttermost part of the earth. Now, it doesn't always go well and positively. In fact, today, we begin with a really negative way of looking at life. So we see what's happening here, and we know Herod. This is the third Herod in the line of kings, and all of the Herods were just horrible people. They really were. They did horrible things. They had very little regard for people or for life. They had lots of regard for their own personal power and the things that interested them. And so Herod is going to play a big part in the story today. He's sort of the bookends of it. But at the end of it, I want us to see that it's still God that is superintending the process, and it's God that is working his plan out in the spreading of the gospel. So we begin with this thought, that Herod the king laid violent hands, is the way my translation puts it. He put hands and he grabbed people with the purpose of hurting them or causing injury or doing damage to the cause of Christ. So he put violent hands on some who belonged to the church. Now, we're only going to hear about two, but perhaps it was a little bit bigger view. And perhaps these were the ones that were sort of seen as the movers and the shakers of the followers of Jesus in Jerusalem. And so because of that, he's trying to get the people that are influencing everybody else, and maybe if he can get rid of them, he can stop this whole mess of followers of Jesus and followers of the way, as they were called, to be the people that are stirring up so much trouble in the city of Jerusalem. So he gets these guys and he puts hands on them, he grabs them, and he does some things. And he essentially puts them in jail. So up on the screen, you're going to see that there's a picture. It's a picture of a first century jail cell. And I don't think, because I just took this in January, I don't believe that the railing and the plexiglass were part of the original design. I think those were added later. But the stone was absolutely there first century. And you can sort of see there's a bench at the back, and there's also two holes in the stone at the top. And so you were either put at the back and chained to something, or you were tied through those holes, and you were there left standing with your arms above your head, depending on what they wanted to do with you. So it wasn't a beautiful spot, and so this was jail, and this is where they got put. And then it says, just like right off the bat, that James is going to get killed by the sword. And so it says he killed James, the brother of John. So that's, you know, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, the disciples. James is the one that is going to be killed. And he's going to be killed by the sword. Now, that's an interesting thought. There was a variety of ways that the Jewish people would execute people. But the sword was sort of maintained as a method of killing people that had been found guilty of drawing people away to strange ways of worship. So if you were guilty of drawing somebody away to idolatry or to someone that would be other than the one true God, whatever that might be, perhaps this is what James was being accused of. He was being one that was causing people to walk away from following the one true God and to follow this troublemaker, Jesus. And so that's probably the thing that he had been charged with, and he's executed. No real trial or anything, just simply done deal. And then it says this, that it pleased the Jewish people. And by that, it probably ultimately means the Jewish religious leaders. They saw it as a win, because now one of the key followers of Jesus has been eliminated. And so Herod, because he's always worrying about his own power, he sees that they're happy with it, and he decides, well, maybe I can just get rid of this whole nuisance all at once. And the best way for me to do that would be to get rid of the guy who seems to be the kingpin leader, and that's Peter. So it says that he gets Peter and takes him into jail as well. So Peter is probably thinking at this point in his life, this is it. I'm going to have the exact same outcome as James did. Like, there's no way of escaping. And so Peter is going to be fussing in the jail cell. It goes on to tell us that because there's a lot of people in town, because it's Passover, and the Bible tells us that was when it was, and it was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that they grabbed him, he's going to get held in prison until after the Passover time. So if you just remember, Passover is a day sort of event, and then the Feast of Unleavened Bread is 7 days following. So you get the sort of 8-day package of festivals and feasts. And so the idea would be, wait until this really important day of Passover for the Jewish people is done. And then during this time of festival, perhaps while no one will really notice what's going on, he can get rid of this nuisance called Peter as well. And so that's what's going to happen. So Peter's probably stewing in prison, which would make perfect sense, because you're thinking that I'm going to have the same outcome as James did just literally days before. The Bible also tells us here that Herod was so set on making sure Peter got this punishment meted out to him as well, is that he put 4 squads of soldiers on him. That means 4 groups of 4. So 16 guys are going to be guarding Peter. And that was probably 4 guys at a time. So 4 would come, be there for 6 hours, they'd swap out. And so every 6 hours, you get 4 fresh guys that are going to be there to guard Peter. And so it seems like this is like the worst case scenario. Peter's probably thinking, this is the way my life is going to end. This is the way it's going to be for me. I'm going to die this way. It's probably the worst day of Peter's life in a lot of ways that these things happen. But I want us to see this, that if there's a truth that we can get out of this, is that God doesn't write everybody's story the same. He's not in the business of just cookie cutter people and lives. He's going to use different people in different ways for different purposes, and he alone knows all the things that are going to happen to him. So Peter's probably thinking, well, I'm going to have the same situation happen to me. I'm going to have the same outcome as James did, and yet God, we're going to see, has a completely different plan. If there's an encouragement or an application thought here for you and for me, it's like, you know what? Just because that's what happens to that person doesn't mean it's going to happen to me. And just because God blesses that person for doing something, it doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to see the same results or the same rewards. And just because someone goes through a difficult time in a given situation doesn't mean that we're going to experience the exact same way. God writes our stories individually, uniquely. And God will use different ways in order to accomplish different purposes. And so I just want you to sort of think that through. Is that just because my story and my life and my experience doesn't match up with those that I think God is blessing in a certain way, doesn't mean God's not going to use our story and our lives to accomplish his purpose. In fact, he can do all those things and use them all in unique ways. So the encouragement for us is God will use our uniqueness for his purposes. And because we think we're not going to be able to be used by God doesn't mean that is going to be the case. In fact, God often uses the differences to draw attention to what he is doing. And a great example of that simply would be that when Jesus healed people, he really never did it the same way twice. Sometimes he spoke, sometimes he spat on the ground and made mud, sometimes he touched people, sometimes he wasn't even in the same town, he just said they're healed. See, God does different. And so we can't sort of put him into a box and say that's the way it's always going to be, that God is always going to operate the exact same way. God is a God of variety, and he uses that variety to draw attention to what he's doing. And I think that's a good thing for us to hold on to. So let's just go on and see what happens. So he's thinking that after Passover, I'm done. And that was Herod's plan too. And so Peter, verse 5, says he's kept in prison. And then there's this word, but. That's that contrast word that we always look for. It says, but earnest prayer for him was being made to God by the church. So in the context of this horrible situation, there's this underside, this sort of clandestine operation that's happening. The church is gathering and they are praying earnestly, passionately, though the word could be fervently. I mean, with lots of conviction, with complete belief, you can put a lot of thoughts into what that earnestly means. But at the end of the day, the church is so concerned about Peter, they actually gather together and they specially pray for him. It was that dire a situation. So they're praying. And what I want us to see in the next portion of the scripture, so from verse 8 right down to like verse 18 or so, 17 at least, I want us to see there's three sort of different views of what happens when God moves and when God is active and when God is at work and when God is doing miraculous things. And I want us to sort of see it in light of this idea that this group of people are praying. And how do people process these three things? So that we're going to look at three different people or people groups, and we're going to see what happens. So let's just take a look. So Herod's about to bring him out that very night. So like the next morning, Peter knows he's going to be done. On that very night, Peter's sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains and sentries before the door that were guarding the prison. So he's there. He's probably chained to those soldiers. So it's like Peter in the middle, chained, connected to the soldiers on either side. And there's guards at the door, and there's a gate that's guarded as well. That's the situation that he's in. That's where he's at. So it says, and then it says, and behold, an angel of the Lord stood next to him, and a light shone in his cell, and he struck Peter on the side, just smacked him on the side, said, hey, wake up. And he says, get up quickly. And then it says this, and the chains fell off his hands. And the angel said, dress, put on your sandals. And he did so. And then the angel said to him, wrap your cloak around you and follow me. And he went out. And so just sort of let's back it up. Peter's probably just got like his the lightest possible shirt on to be comfortable. And this angel wakes him up, smacks him on the side, says, wake up, get dressed. The chains fall off, because that would be hard to put a cloak over a chain. And the chains fall off. And he says, get up and get on your sandals. We got a hike to do tonight. And so here's Peter, like woken up out of the sleep. And then it says this about Peter. And I'm sure he knows there's people praying for him. And I'm sure he knows that God is with him. And I'm sure he knows that God has a plan. And I'm sure he knows that no matter what happens, that his faith is in the right person, Jesus, and that he's trusting him to take care of him. But then it says this. And he went out and he followed him, the angel, but he did not know what was being done by the angel was real. And he thought maybe he was seeing a vision. He thought maybe he was dreaming all of this, because that would be like wishful thinking, right? That maybe I'm not going to lose my head tomorrow. Maybe I'm going to actually get rescued. So Peter is still sort of not sure, is this real? Is this actually happening to me? Or am I sort of dreaming it, hoping it, wishing it? So he wasn't sure that God was actually at work. Then it says this in verse 10. He went and he passed through the first and the second guard. So that's probably those guys that were at the gate that had been set there. And then it says this, and then he came to the gate leading to the city. And so the dungeon that we were in actually just had a gate that opened up that would allow you to walk out into the city of Jerusalem. And so that's what that's talking about. And it says this, and the gate actually opened by itself. That lock all of a sudden didn't operate anymore, and the gate opened by itself. So all these supernatural things, in the midst of all of this, the guards are so asleep, they're so out of it, that clearly God has got them in such a stupor that they're completely oblivious to chains falling and people moving around and gates opening. See, that's the miraculous part too, beyond the fact that there's an angel in the cell with Peter and the fact that all of this has happened. And it says they went out and they went into a street, and then the angel leaves. And it's at that point that Peter goes, hang on a second, this is, God has miraculously rescued me. It took him a while to come to that spot where God was actually doing what he thought God was doing. There's probably a good lesson for us too. You know, we don't always see what God is doing, but we need to be assured of this, that God is always doing, that he's always working, that he's always active in our lives, and we don't always understand it. We don't always see it necessarily, but we need to understand that God is always working. And Peter comes to that conclusion that God had done a miraculous thing, that he was working in his life, even though Peter wasn't actually convinced it was happening. All of a sudden, clarity comes. He sees what God has done, and so now he realizes that what man had planned and what the Jewish leaders were looking forward to had all been squashed by the moving of God and his invading their plans and destroying them in one quick evening. Verse 12 tells us that he then goes to a house. He realizes that this is real, and he goes to the house of Mary. And here's just an interesting description. So let's just sort of read it. So look at verse 12 to 14. When he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name was Mark. First time we've heard of this guy, it won't be the last, okay? So just put that in your memory banks, John Mark. So the mother of John, whose other name was Mark, and she must have been a person of some degree of wealth, because in her house there were many people gathered and they were praying. And it says this in verse 13. And when he knocked at the door of the gateway, a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer. So this girl comes to the door, again showing that there must be some degree of affluence in this woman's world. And so Rhoda comes to the door, and then look what it says in verse 14. Recognizing Peter's voice, and we always make fun of this poor girl, recognizing Peter's voice, in her joy, she did not open the gate, but ran in and reported that Peter was standing at the gate. So you can sort of picture this young girl. The Bible doesn't tell us how old, just that she's young, a servant girl. So that word means, you know, probably, I'm thinking teens. Anyway, she's in a typical teenage girl excitement, sort of loses track of what's going on, and she's so excited that Peter is at the door. She actually doesn't think, oh, I should let him in. She runs back into the prayer meeting and says, Peter is at the door. So Peter's not sure what's going on, but it's amazing, this little servant girl, she's absolutely certain of what's going on. Like, she has no doubt that God has done something, and Peter is now at the door. Like, there's no doubt in her world. She's so excited. She does what she shouldn't do and leaves the poor guy standing out in the street of Jerusalem waiting to be caught by whoever happens to wander by. Anyway, so we see this guy who's not quite sure, and then this servant girl who's absolutely sure of what God has done. And then here's the group of people. And I want us to see their response, because it's interesting too. In verse 15, it says she goes in, and they say to her, look at this. Like, here's the amazing part, and here's the gut check, I think, for all of us. But they say to her, you are out of your mind. You're crazy. You are crazy, girl. Yeah. Let's just think about that for a second. Because let me just bring it to us at the same time while I'd apply it to them. Because think of it, they're all gathering together. They're praying about something big. They're praying about their friend who's about to literally lose his head. They're praying about a leader that they care for and they see as really important in moving the truth of the gospel, the good news of the gospel, out into the world. They're praying hard for him. They're at night, they're gathering together, they're passionately praying. They're praying to God. And yet, when God actually moves, what's their response? That can't be true. God couldn't have answered our prayer. Really? Did he really? girl, you're crazy. That's their first thought. They try and theologicize it a little bit. I don't think that's a word, but it is now. They try and massage it so that it seems religious. You're not seeing Peter. You're seeing Peter's guardian angel, which was a theological concept of the Jewish people, that everyone had a guardian angel. And on occasion, if necessary, this person, guardian angel, would appear and then appear in the likeness of that person. That's not a biblical idea, but that was a widely held concept in the culture. So they're thinking, you're not seeing Peter, you're seeing Peter's guardian angel. Girl, you're crazy. God hasn't answered our prayers, even though we're praying, believing. I thought, wow. We talk a good game sometimes about prayer. We say it's important. We talk about prayer being vital, prayer being powerful, prayer changing things. And yet, sometimes we struggle to even gather people together to wedge into our busy schedules some time to pray at all. And then, when we pray, I think we'd all say that we pray believing God can do anything. But then maybe something in the back of our mind changes, because when God actually does do something, sometimes we don't believe it. Or maybe even worse. Maybe we're all guilty of sometimes praying because it's the thing to do, but somehow we don't actually believe that God's going to answer it. Like, God actually isn't going to get Peter out. He's going to make it easier for him when he dies. I don't know. But we don't actually believe that God can do what we think is impossible. I think that's what God's always wanting us to do. He wants all of us to understand that prayer is the declaration that we are unbelievably dependent on God, that we are completely unable to do it ourselves, and so we cry out to God because He's the one that can do it, and we're the ones that can't. I don't think our church prays like that. I don't think I pray like that sometimes. And that's what they were doing. They're praying and they're going, can't be. God couldn't have actually answered our prayers like fast too. Peter's not sure. Rhoda, absolutely sure. So we make fun of this poor girl, but she's the one that actually has the most belief that God actually is doing what she thinks God will do. And then there's this group of people that are praying, and they just don't believe that God would answer in that way. And this interesting way of looking at it. I just think there's a great challenge there. Finally, they get the poor guy in off the street, and he tells them what happened. He says, go tell James. Now, just for clarity's sake, he's not telling go tell James the guy that just had his head removed from his body. It's not that James. It's James, the leader of the church in Jerusalem. James, the brother of Jesus. James, the guy who we're going to see a few times in Acts in the next few chapters. It's James, Jesus' brother, who's a leader. He's saying, go tell the leadership of the church what God has done. And then it says, and then Peter took off to another spot for safety's sake, I think. And then we see the story to switch here. So look at verse 18. It says, now when day came, I like the way that my version says it, and the King James says it very similarly. There was no little disturbance among the soldiers over what had become of Peter. In other words, it was a big deal what happened to Peter. Like, there was going to be problems. And Herod was not happy. He was not happy at all because his prisoner that he had taken, gone to great lengths to make sure wasn't going to escape, had escaped. And ultimately, the two or four guys that were watching him lost their lives in lieu of Peter. So Herod was really irritated beyond description. And Herod looks for him, and he can't find him, verse 19. And so these guys pay the price. And then it says this, and Herod goes down to, from Judea, then in Jerusalem, to Caesarea, which is that spot we've heard about a lot, that spot on the coast, and spent some time there. So you sort of think that's kind of the end of the story. God does an amazing thing, spares Peter, and Peter's now on the run for his life, and he's hiding, and Herod's looking for him, and he can't find him. So you kind of think, okay, well, that's maybe the end of the story, but it's not. It's not. And so my point is this, that the last five or six verses of the chapter, you can sort of look at and go, not connected to the story. But that's not true. In fact, they're really important for us to sort of understand what God is doing. So let's take a quick look. So Herod goes and he spends some time in Caesarea. And then it says this, that in verse 26, that he is angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon. So up on the screen, you're going to see a picture. There's a map. And at the bottom of the map, you see Caesarea on the coast. And then if you go to the top of the map on the coast as well, there's two cities, one called Tyre and one called Sidon. So he's irritated at those people. And they're wondering what to do and how they can mend some relationships. So Herod's irritated. It doesn't say why, but it does say that they really wanted to make sure that the food supply chain was going to be okay. And that's what verse 20 tells us, is that they actually go to the chamberlain, like the number two guy for the king. And his name was Blastus, which is a great name for a guy who probably is full of himself. So anyway, and this is all we know about this guy, by the way. So they convince him to let them come and talk to King Herod to make sure that they're not going to starve because Herod's irritated at them. Again, you're going, how is that connected to the story? Well, let's just sort of wait and see. So the picture you see there has got those three towns. And then this will give you just a bit of an insight into Herod. This is the picture is actually a picture of the ruins, and we're actually sort of standing on inside the palace of Herod. You see in front of him his back porch, which is that flat, sort of intricate spot that's got lots of patterning there. And then beyond that, you see what's left of Herod's pool, his swimming pool. And then beyond that is the Mediterranean. So you sort of see Herod had like the first infinity edge swimming pool ever created. And there was. And by the way, he wasn't a guy you wanted to have invite you over to come for a swim. So just so you see, because he would often invite his political enemies. And part of what he would do is say, well, let's go for a swim. And then he would say, well, let's see what happens if I hold you under the water for 5 or 10 minutes. And a lot of people drown in Herod's swimming pool. And that's the kind of guy that he was. So it looks like a beautiful spot. It also looks like a spot that you could kill people. And that's what Herod chose to do. That's Herod. That's his mindset. Whatever it took for him to keep power, that's what he did. So let's continue on with the story. Herod's not happy. He goes to Caesarea. These people have irritated him, and now let's see what happens. The next day, on the day that the agreement was, verse 21 says, Herod puts on his royal robe. So he gets all dressed up, like a king should, and he sits on his throne, power, authority, and he delivers a great speech. The Bible says that he delivers an oration to him. That means he thought a long time about it and put together a lot of really nice words and said some things. There's probably a comment I could make about politicians at that point, but I will not. But that's what he does. He delivers this great speech. And it must have been good, because look what it says this afterwards, verse 22. And the people were shouting, the voice of a god and not of a man. In other words, they're saying, this guy's a god. The people in Caesarea are going, we need a god of the town. Let's make Herod our god. I think the problem that comes here is that Herod didn't say, no, I'm just a guy. I'm not a god. He actually said, well, yeah, maybe. If that's the way you want to look at it, we can work with that. Well, we can roll with you calling me a god. I'm okay with that. That's pride. That's all that is. It's his pride and ego and arrogance and all those words that none of us want to be described like, but that's the way he was. And then it says this, and immediately, verse 23, an angel of the Lord struck him down because he did not give God the glory. In other words, it reminds us of the words of Isaiah where it says, I am the Lord and I share my glory with no one. And Herod wanted his slice of the action. And God says, I am a jealous God and I share my glory with no one. An angel of the Lord comes down and strikes him. And look at this. Interesting what happens. Because he gives this great speech and people go, that's fantastic. You're amazing. You're like a God. And then God takes over. And God takes over in a dramatic way because it says an angel comes and strikes him. And then it says this, and look at the way it describes him. And he was eaten by worms and breathed his last. Josephus, who's a Jewish historian, only describes the death of Herod as intense pain in his bowels. That's the way it was. His guts were really upset, incredibly painful. But Dr. Luke gives the medical background for it. And just look at the order of the way things happen. The angel strikes Herod. And then it says, and he was eaten by worms. And then he died. That would be a bad way to go. That would be a bad way to go. Having your insides eaten out while you're alive would be tough. That would be bad. That would be a bad day. That would be a bad day. But God is saying, I share my glory with no one. And if you think you're a God, I will show you how much of a God you are. And God always deals with arrogance. God always opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. God always does that. He opposes the proud. You want to elevate yourself to deity? I will show you what deity does. And I will show you what idolatry costs you. And I'll show you what pride and arrogance does to you. It destroys. And that's what God does. So now Herod is dead. And now you're still probably thinking, but hang on, how is this connected at all to the bit of the story about Peter and James? How is that connected? See, God takes over. But what I want you to remember is, up until the point of the death of Herod, he's still looking for Peter. And in that moment, the one that is pursuing Peter is gone. Herod is dead. He is off the scene. The threat to Peter's life has been completely taken away now. And God has done both. He set him free from the jail, and he's also got rid of the one that was pursuing him. See, Herod is dead, and God takes care of those details. And then it says this, and the upside is this, but the word of Herod, it went nowhere. It died the day that Herod died. But look at verse 24. But the word of God increased and multiplied. Again, we see that great word. The good news of Jesus is spreading bigger and bigger and bigger. And so we see this great superintendent, this working of God, taking care of his people, doing stuff in his way, in his timing, and he gets glory for it. And then we see the last verse of the chapter is really a transitionary verse again. Because now Peter goes off of the scene, and two guys that we last saw last chapter come back. Look at verse 25. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem. So they're back. They had delivered the gifts to help the impoverished people in the famine in Jerusalem, and they return now to Antioch. That's where they're returning to. And when they completed their service. And then look at this. Remember I said we weren't done with John Mark? And bringing with them John, whose other name was Mark. And we're going to find out that, in fact, John Mark is the cousin of Barnabas. And John Mark is now going to be part of a team. He's a new guy that's going to be part of the missionary team that's going to go out and that God is going to use in amazing ways. We get introduced to him in the middle of a crisis, and now all of a sudden we see now he's not just this guy who we get a name for reference. We actually find out that God's got a plan for him. And it's not going to be the one that you think or that I would think should happen. When this handpicked guy comes on the team, you think God is going to just do amazing stuff and it's going to be great. We'll see what happens to this young guy. But the point now is that now the story switches back from Peter to Saul and to Barnabas. And we're going to see what happens to them when we look at chapter 13 next week. So really, at the end of it, I want us to really do two things. Number one, God doesn't write all the stories the same. So just because your story isn't somebody else's doesn't mean God can't use you. God's going to use what he is writing in your life. The circumstances he's writing in your life, he will use if you will let him use it for his glory. So see the ways that your life can bring glory to God. See the way your life can share the good news of Jesus. Give hope to people that are hopeless. Give answers to the questions that they have about the stuff that really matters. God will use your life in unique ways that he couldn't use anybody else to do. He will use us. The second thing is, man, when we pray, we better learn to pray like we actually believe God's going to answer. And then understand this, finally, that God really, he's going to lift up the humble, and he will always deal with those that rise up in pride and in arrogance. We have some good lessons to learn out of this chapter. And above all, God uses all of those circumstances for his word to go forward, to magnify Jesus, to lift him up, and to reach the world with the good news that makes a difference for eternity. Let me pray for us, and then we'll be done. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your word. And we thank you that you've given it to us so that we can live lives that please you and honor you and glorify you. Pray that as we go through this week that you will help us to see opportunities that are uniquely ours to live for you and serve you and please you. God, help us to be people of prayer that actually believe you'll do what we ask because you are the God who can do anything. And God, I pray you give us humble spirits as we simply are your servants, your instruments, your tools to accomplish your purposes for this brief moment you give us called life. God, be with us as we go through difficult, challenging days and help us to do it with an outlook that sees your blessing even in the midst of struggles that we go through. God, help us to be optimistic, because we don't know what the next days hold, but we know what eternity holds for those that love Jesus. God, help us to live lives that are filled with hope so that others will see the difference you make. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.